It's another beautiful day to read a story. Hello, hello, my lovelies. Today's story is called Puss in Boots. Once upon a time, there was a miller who had three sons. He was so poor that when he died, he left nothing but his mill, his donkey, and his cat. The mill, of course, had to be left to his eldest son. The donkey went to his second son. Then all that was left for the youngest was his father's cat. Alice, Puss is no use to me, and I am too poor even to feed him, said the youngest son.
Meow, meow. Do not worry, dear master. Give me a pair of boots and a bag, and you will find that we are not as badly off as you think, said the cat.
The miller's son was very surprised to hear a cat talking. I would be too. A cat that can talk is perhaps clever enough to do as he promises, he thought to himself. So with his last few coins, the miller's son bought Puss a pair of boots and a bag. Puss was delighted with the boots. He pulled them on and strutted up and down in front of his master.
Meow, meow, I look so good.
He looked so proud of himself that the miller's son could not help but laugh at him. From that time onwards, the miller's son always called him Puss in Boots. Then Puss slung the bag over his shoulder and went off to the garden. There he gathered some fresh lettuce leaves, which he put in his bag. Next, Puss in Boots set off across the fields. He stopped when he came to a rabbit hole. Then, leaving the mouth of his bag open, he lay quietly down nearby. A plump rabbit soon peeped out of the hole. It smelled the fresh lettuce leaves and came nearer. They were too tempting. First, the rabbit's nose went into the bag, then its head, and quickly, Puss pulled the strings and the rabbit was caught. With the rabbit in his bag, Puss in Boots marched off to the palace and asked to see the king.
Meow, meow, your majesty, please accept this rabbit as a gift from my lord, the Marquis of Carabas. Meow.
The king was amused by this cat wearing boots and talking.
Tell your master that I accept his gift and I am much obliged, said the king.
On another day, Puss again lay down as if he were dead in a field. Once more, his bag was open beside him. This time, he caught two fine partridges. Again, Puss in Boots took his catch to the king. As before, the king accepted the gift from the Marquis of Carabas. He was so pleased with the partridges that he ordered the cat to be taken to the royal kitchen and fed.
Lucky Puss in Boots.
As it happened, the king had a daughter who was said to be the most beautiful princess in the world. One day, Puss in Boots heard the king and his daughter were going for a drive along by the river. Puss ran immediately to the miller's son and said,
Meow, meow, my master. If you will now do as I tell you, your future will be meow made.
What would you have me do? Said the miller's son.
Meow, come with me, my master. Meow, meow, meow.
And he led him to the bank of the river.
Meow, there are only two things, meow, I want you to do. First, you must bathe here in the river, meow, and then you are not yourself, but the meow, meow, Marquis of Carabas.
I have never heard of the Marquis of Carabas, said the miller's son, but I will do as you say. While the miller's son was bathing in the river, the royal carriages came into sight. The king was in his carriage with his daughter beside him. His nobles were riding nearby. Suddenly, they were startled by a cry of, "Help! Help! My meow, Lord, the Marquis of Carabas is drowning!" The king looked out of his carriage. He could see no one but Puss in Boots, who was running up and down beside the river. However, the king told his nobles to quickly help the drowning man. Puss ran back to the king as soon as the nobles had dragged his master from the river. Making a low bow, he said, "Meow, your majesty, what shall my poor master do? For a thief has stolen his clothes, meow." Now the truth was that Puss in Boots had hidden the clothes under a large stone.
"That is most unfortunate," said the king. "We cannot leave him there without clothes." So he gave orders to a servant to fetch a suit from the palace. When the miller's son was dressed in a suit of good clothes, he looked like a very fine man indeed. The king then invited him to go for a ride with them. So the miller's son sat in the carriage beside the princess. Puss ran on quickly ahead of the carriage. He stopped when he reached the meadow where the mowers were cutting the grass.
"Meow, meow, the king is coming this way, and he may ask you whose meadow this is. Unless you say that it belongs to the Marquis of Carabas, you shall all be chopped as fine as mincemeat."
The mowers were simple fellows, and they were terrified to hear a cat talking in such a fierce voice. A few minutes later, the king and his nobles drove by. As the king passed the large, lovely meadow, he stopped his carriage and spoke to the mowers.
"Tell me who owns this fine meadow?"
"It belongs to the Marquis of Carabas, your majesty," said the mowers. At that, the king turned to the miller's son.
"You do indeed own the fine meadow, my lord."
Meanwhile, Puss had run further on along the road. He reached a cornfield in which reapers were busy cutting the corn.
"Meow, meow, the king will soon drive by. He might ask, meow, whose cornfields these are. Unless you say that they belong to the Marquis of Carabas, you shall be chopped as fine as minced meow meat."
The reapers, just like the mowers, were terrified to hear a cat talking in such a fierce voice. A few minutes later, the king and his nobles came into sight. Once more, the king stopped his carriage.
"Tell me who owns these cornfields?"
"They belong to Marquis of Carabas," said the reapers.
"What a rich man he must be, and how handsome he looks. I do believe he would make a good husband for my daughter," said the king to himself.
Now the fields really belonged to an ogre, and this ogre lived in a castle a little farther along. Puss in Boots hurried along the road until he reached the castle. Then he knocked on the door, which was opened by the ogre himself.
"Meow, sir. I am on a journey, and as I have often heard how wonderful you are, meow, I have taken the liberty, meow, of calling to see you."
The ogre was startled to hear a cat talking, yet he was pleased to learn that the cat had heard how wonderful he was. He immediately invited Puss into his castle.
"Meow, I have heard that you can change yourself, meow, into any animal you choose."
"That is true," said the ogre, and he instantly changed himself into a lion.
Puss got a terrible fright. "Meow!" He quickly scrambled to the top of a very high dresser out of harm's way. At once, the ogre changed himself from a lion back to an ogre again. And then Puss jumped down.
"Meow, sir, I must say that you frightened me. Yet it must not be too difficult for such a large fellow as yourself to change into a large animal like a lion. Meow. It would be even more wonderful if a huge ogre could change himself into a tiny animal. I suppose you couldn't change yourself into a mouse. Meow.
Could not. I can change myself into anything I choose. You shall see.
Immediately, he became a little gray mouse, which scampered across the floor in front of Puss and Boots with one spring. Puss pounced upon the mouse and gobbled it up. So that was the end of the ogre. By the time the king's carriages were arriving at the castle, Puss in Boots, hearing the carriage wheels, ran to the gate. Bowing low, he said,
"Meow, welcome, your majesty, to the castle of Mickey of Carabas."
"What, my lord," said the king, "does this castle also belong to you? I have nothing so grand in my whole kingdom," said the king.
The miller's son did not speak, but gave his hand to the princess to help her from the carriage. They all entered the castle, where they found a wonderful feast ready to be served. It had been prepared for guests whom the ogre had expected. Fortunately, the ogre's friends did not arrive, as news had reached them that the king was in the castle. The king and the princess, the nobles and the miller's son all sat down in the feast. Puss in Boots stood by the side of his master. Every moment, the king became more and more charmed with the miller's son. By the time the feast was over, the king said,
"There is no one in the world I would rather have as my son-in-law. I now make you a prince," said the king.
Then the prince said that there was no one in the world he would like so much for his wife as the princess. And the princess said there was no one in the world she would like so much for a husband as the prince. So the two were married and lived happily ever after in the ogre's castle. Puss in Boots was very happy living in the castle. He was always the greatest favorite with the king, the prince, and the princess. Never again did Puss have to hunt for a meal. He lived on the fat of the land until the end of his days. The end. Meow. Isn't that a funny story? A cat that talks. Who's amazing? You are amazing, my friend. I am amazing. You are amazing. We are amazing. Until the next time, keep on being amazing.